As you can tell from the title, we are going to be, as the theme of this camp meeting is dealing, centering on the Day of Atonement. I thought that I would study with you about the atonement of suffering. Now, this, of course, is not going to be an exhaustive study or a complete study by any means. I only have an hour to do so. And when you're dealing with the subject of the atonement, there's so much that you have to cover and so much to consider. That's why throughout this whole week and weekend, from the various speakers, I'm sure you will get various angles of this topic and hopefully a more complete picture. So there are going to be a whole lot, much that I will not address in this one presentation because of the time. And so I'm sure you're going to be left with some questions, and I will be around to answer any questions that you may have or any further thoughts that you would want to share with me. But I'll do my best to touch a little bit, just a glimpse into what I've called the atonement of suffering. In July of 1768, the founding father, John Dickinson, known as the Penman of the Revolution, he wrote a song called the Liberty Song. In it, he wrote what would later become known as the official motto of the state of Kentucky. Anyone know what that motto is? Kentucky's state motto. Anyone in here from Kentucky? All right, the Kentucky official motto is, in fact, I'll just quote you what he said, and then you'll get the motto here in a moment. He says in the song Liberty, the Liberty song, he said, "Then join hand in hand, brave Americans all. By uniting we stand, by dividing we fall." Now, 31 years later, Patrick Henry, in his last public speech, said the following: "Let us trust God and our better judgment to set us right hereafter. United we stand, divided we fall. Let us not split into factions which must destroy that union upon which our existence hangs." Now, he died 2 months after he gave this speech. But one of the things that we notice, not just with the founding fathers of America, but throughout the history of humanity, man has always recognized the need for some kind of oneness or unity. In August of 1892, the socialist minister, Francis Bellamy, composed the Pledge of Allegiance. Now, his desire was that the pledge would be used by any country. As I have here timelined, in its original form, it read, "I pledge allegiance to my flag and the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all." Now, in 1923, the United States added the words, "the flag of the United States." And so it read, "I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all." A year later, the words of America were adopted. In 1924, the words of America were adopted to it. And then in 1954, President Dwight Eisenhower encouraged Congress to add the words "under God." And so it stands as it is often read today. But again, this just shows the desire that man has had and continue to have for some kind of oneness or unity. Alexandre Dumas, who is known for his book, The Three Musketeers, he wrote this in a book. He says, "All for one and one for all. United we stand, divided we fall." I only give these quotations to show the intimate desire that mankind has always recognized for oneness or unity. Now, of course, Jesus himself talked about what we've just been reading from these individuals. Turn with me to the book of Mark, chapter 3. And we're going to be studying, we're going to go through several texts today. It's going to be a Bible study, actually. Some of this may be the Atonement 101 to most of you. But we want to see here what Jesus says about this division and unity. Mark chapter 3 and verse 25. It says, "And if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot what?
Stand.
Cannot stand." Now, of course, this is what many Christians, what has inspired many Christians throughout the centuries when it comes to that unity. This is something that they have often considered, the fact that a house divided cannot stand. Amos also talked about the importance of oneness. In Amos 3:3, he says, "Can two walk together except they be what?
Agreed."
The understanding of a oneness having that is needing, a unity, an agreement that is needing. We also learn about this in several places in the New Testament. Let's go first of all to Ephesians chapter 4. Other text that speaks about a oneness or one. Ephesians chapter 4. And we're going to begin in verse 4. Again, these are well-known passages, but one for us to consider as we think about man's need or desire or his recognition of the need for oneness. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning in verse 4. It says, "There is one body and one spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all." If we were to go through and count how many times the word one is mentioned, we would recognize, at least in these passages, the strength that there is in the fact that there is only one. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. And when we really think about that, one God, one church, one body. Just over and over and over, the word one mentioned here. And again, we can find this throughout the Bible, the importance of this oneness or the ideal of oneness. But if we were to consider the most critical one, what would that one be? If we were to consider the most critical one, what would it be?
Hear, O Israel.
Hear, O Israel. The Lord thy God is one. I actually want to show you another one. And it is found in John chapter 17. John chapter 17, Jesus here talks about another oneness, which goes along with what we've been introducing so far. John chapter 17. And notice what Jesus says in verse 11, first of all. "And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee. Holy Father, keep through thy name, through thine own name, those whom thou hast given me, that they may be what?
One
as we are." So Jesus here in prayer to his Father. Now, this is the prayer of Jesus, mind you. And I'm sure all of us in this room have offered up prayers and are offering up prayers right now to God for something important in our lives, for something that we deem very critical or essential, something that we may even desire. Now, if we ourselves have prayers that are critical and desire, how much more is the prayer of Christ more critical? Here, Jesus is actually praying. And he asks in his prayer that they may be one as we are one. And how is this to take place? Drop down a few lines to verse 21. How are they to be one? Verse 21, it says, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us. Could someone just give me a cup of water, please? It's right there. Thank you so much. Reading verse 21 once again. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee. That they also may be one in us. That the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. That they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and thou in me. That they may be made perfect in one. And that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. So Jesus here tells us how we may be one. He says that we may be one even as the Father and Son are one. But I want you to notice something here that stands out in this verse, particularly in verse 23. He says that they may be made perfect in what? Can perfection be attained out of oneness? Here Jesus here gives us a clue as to how this oneness that he's praying for here is to transpire. Here, how this perfection is to transpire, and it's to transpire in a oneness. Now, someone may ask, well, what does this have to do with the Day of Atonement? And that is when we get more into our study. First of all, I want you to notice a few quotations that I have here, an inspiration. The first one is First Selected Messages, page 375. Jesus says of them, I in them, and thou in me. That they may be made perfect in one. And this is included in the text. She says, this unity brings perfection of what?
Character.
Of character. And that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. The Lord has made every provision whereby man may have full and free salvation and be complete in him. Again, another one, to bring humanity into Christ, to bring the fallen race into oneness with what?
Divinity
is the work of redemption. What is the work of redemption? To bring us, to bring humanity, to bring mankind into oneness with divinity. Again, this is something that man has always desired and recognized the strength of, a oneness, a unity. But the most critical oneness that we need is the oneness with divinity.
Amen.
And this here, as it goes on to say, is the work of redemption. This is the plan of redemption, which includes the final work of the atonement. Go with me to Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. And we want to look at some of the ways in which the word atonement is found in the New Testament and how it is used. Romans chapter 5. And notice here what we read in verse 10 and 11. Romans chapter 5, verse 10 and 11. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. Now, in the King James Version here, we find that this is the only place in the New Testament where the word atonement is translated as atonement. The Greek word that is used here, this is the only place where it's translated as atonement. But this is the Thayer's definition of the Greek word that is translated here, atonement. It simply means an adjustment of a difference or reconciliation. It means the restoration to favor. So what Paul is talking about here is a reconciliation that we have received, or as the translation put it, an atonement. It's also used in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, the same word here, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 18. It says, "And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given us the ministry of reconciliation, to wit, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation." So here we're simply talking about the act of being reconciled. That is the way in which this word is used here. It's the act of being reconciled, not talking about the offering or the sacrifice by which reconciliation is possible. The word that we find used here in 2 Corinthians as well as in Romans, translated atonement, the word means the act of being reconciled or an adjustment of a difference. It really does not cover the offering or the sacrifice that is made to make the atonement. So we want to look now at the way in which the word is used to refer to the sacrifice itself. And that word is mentioned in 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. And we will read verses 1 and 2. "My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world." So here the Apostle John says that Jesus is the propitiation. Now there's a different word used there. And in Strong's, the Strong's Concordance here, the Greek word used for propitiation is an atonement or an expiator. Something that is used to atone for. And in this sense, it refers to the offering that is made, the sacrifice that is made to make an atonement, to bring an at-one-ment. Which when you break down the word atonement, that's what it means, to be at one with someone, to be reconciled with someone. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 10, this word is also used, the word propitiation. 1 John 4:10, "Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins." In other words, Jesus is the atonement. He is the expiator for our sins, the one by whom we can receive reconciliation. Now, what was the purpose for which God wanted the children of Israel to build a sanctuary?
He might dwell among them.
We know that text, right? In Exodus 25, it tells us that he wanted to dwell among his people. God wanted to be in the midst of his people. He wanted to be with them and they with him. And so he wanted them to build this sanctuary that he could come and dwell among them. And also, in fact, go to Exodus chapter 25. Not just dwell among them, but we find here as we read a little further in the same chapter, Exodus 25 and verse 21. Exodus 25 and thou shalt, and verse 21, the Bible says, and thou shalt put the mercy seat above upon the ark, and in the ark thou shalt put the testimony that I shall give thee. And there will I, what? Meet with thee, and I will commune with thee from above the mercy seat. So here is where God wanted to meet with his people and commune with them, to communicate his thoughts to them, his will to them. And he wanted them to make a sanctuary. Now we, of course, I know that I am studying right now with those of you who have studied out the sanctuary, at least to know the different compartments or apartments that it had, the courtyard, the first apartment being the holy place and the most holy place. And so a lot of this, I'm going to assume you already know. But here we find that in the most holy place, which is where the ark was located and the mercy seat, God said, there's where I wanted to commune with you, to meet with you. And as the priests would go in and inquire of the will of God, of course, he wearing the breastplate with the Urim and Thummim on it, which was used to reveal the will of God. And even in the time of Moses, when Moses went to the altar of incense that was right before the most holy place, there he heard God's voice communing with him from the glory between the cherubims. That is where God met with his people and communed with them. That's where he revealed his will to them. It was there in the holy, in the most holy. Now, how often was the priest allowed into the holy place of the sanctuary?
Daily.
On a daily basis, correct? Correct. Go to Exodus now. No, Leviticus chapter 4. Leviticus chapter 4. We find here that the priest was, he entered into it every day, but for what reason? For what purposes? Leviticus chapter 4 and verse 27, beginning there. Leviticus 4:27 says, and if any one of the common people sin through ignorance, while he doeth somewhat against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning things which ought not to be done, and be guilty, and then it talks about in verse 28, if his sin is sin that it comes to his knowledge, then what he shall bring to be offered. Go to verse 29. And he shall lay his hand upon the head of the sin offering and slay the sin offering in the place of the burnt offering. And the priest shall take of the blood therewith with his finger and put it upon the horns of the altar of burnt offering and shall pour out all the blood thereof at the bottom of the altar. Verse 31. And he shall take away all the fat thereof, as the fat is taken away from off the sacrifice of peace offerings. And the priest shall burn it upon the altar for a sweet savor unto the Lord. And the priest shall make a what? An atonement for him, and it shall be forgiven him. So here we find that, of course, when the sinner would bring his offering to the to the sanctuary in order to present his offering, whether it be a sin offering or a peace offering or a meat offering, the priest, especially concerning the sin offering, would take the blood of the sacrifice and enter into the holy place to sprinkle the blood. Right. When it came to the offering of the priest, as it says here in Leviticus 4, because there was offering made for a priest, there was an offering made for the common people, the rulers. When these different offerings were made, when it came to the priest.
But in the common person, it was never taken in.
No, the fat was burned at the altar, and the priest ate the offering in the holy place.
626.
Correct. Okay. All right. So once the blood was taken into the sanctuary, especially concerning the sacrifice of the priest, which we didn't read, thereby being transferred to the sanctuary, the priest would also minister at the altar of incense. He would burn incense every morning and every evening, signifying continual prayers being offering up to God. And this took place on a daily basis. Also in Exodus chapter 30, if we would turn to Exodus chapter 30, Exodus chapter 30 and verse 1. It says, "And thou shalt make an altar of burnt incense to burn incense upon. Of shittim wood shalt thou make it." Drop down now to verse 6. "And thou shalt put it before the veil that is by the ark of the testimony, before the mercy seat that is over the testimony, where I will meet with thee, and Aaron shall burn thereon sweet incense every morning when he dresseth the lamps, and he shall burn incense upon it. And when Aaron lighteth the lamps at evening, he shall burn incense upon it, a perpetual incense before the Lord throughout your generations." So not only was the priest there for bringing the sacrifices to the holy place, but he also burnt incense in the holy place. A continual intercession being provided for the people of Israel. And of course, the people of Israel were represented in the priest. The priest represented the people. Now, what about the most holy place? How often was the priest allowed to enter into that compartment? And for what purpose? For the cleansing of it. All right, Leviticus chapter 16 now. We're getting to a point, so hold on. Leviticus chapter 16. Leviticus 16 and verse 2. It says, "And the Lord said unto Moses, speak unto Aaron thy brother, that he come not at all times into the holy place within the veil before the mercy seat, which is upon the ark, that he die not. For I will appear in the cloud upon the mercy seat." Verse 29 now. "And this shall be the statute forever unto you, that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, ye shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, whether it be one of your own country or a stranger that sojourneth among you. For on that day shall the priest make an atonement for you to cleanse you, that ye may be clean from all your sins from before the Lord." Verse 33. "And he shall make an atonement for the holy sanctuary, and he shall make an atonement for the tabernacle of congregation and for the altar, and he shall make an atonement for the priests and for all the people of the congregation." Now, in the work of the priests in the holy place, was an atonement made for the people?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
There was an atonement made, and this atonement was made on a daily basis. But that atonement is what brought them forgiveness. But here, on a specific day of the year, God, through Moses, here saying that the high priest going into the most holy was to make an atonement also. Now we want to look at this a little bit more in depth. Go to Hebrews chapter 9. Paul explains the two atonements here in Hebrews chapter 9 in these words. Hebrews 9 verses 1 through 3. He says, "Then verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service and a worldly sanctuary. For there was a tabernacle made, the first wherein was the candlestick, the table, and the showbread, which is called the sanctuary. And after the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all." Verse 6. Now when these things were thus ordained, the priest went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. But into the second went the high priest alone once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. So here we find that the priest went always into the first apartment, accomplishing the services of God, which we briefly took a look at what the priest did on a daily basis in the holy place, which was also called an atonement. But once a year they went into the most holy, and as it says here in verse 7, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the heirs of the people. When we seek to understand the atonement, we must keep in mind that there is a two-phase atonement, or what is often called a dual atonement. Many Christians believe that the atonement was finalized and finished by the death of Christ on the cross. And so the work that he conducts in heaven for us, merely interceding for us, is not a part of atoning for us. But when we study the sanctuary out and understand the two phases of Christ's work, once we study the phases of the ancient Day of Atonement, we recognize that, yes, there was an atonement made through the sacrifices that we're offering, but there was also a final atonement, which we call the Day of Atonement. This is when the final atonement was made for who?
For the church.
Okay, specifically for ancient Israel. Who was that final atonement made for? Was it for the whole world? Exactly. It was for those who had prior to that confessed their sins and brought their sins to Christ, brought their sins, their sins to the sanctuary, to the animals that were sacrificed. That is who benefited in the Day of Atonement. So there's two phases or divisions of the atonement. And the atonement is a process, not a single act. It is not something that was finished at the cross. It's a process that takes place. Now, what was the process of the Day of Atonement for ancient Israel? Let's take a brief look at that back in the Leviticus chapter 16. So look at the process that transpired. Leviticus chapter 16. First of all, verse 3. Leviticus 16 and verse 3 says, Thus shall Aaron come into the holy place with a young bullock for a sin offering and a ram for a burnt offering. Verse 5, and he shall take of the congregation of the children of Israel two kids of the goats for a sin offering and one ram for a burnt offering. And Aaron shall offer his bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself, and make an atonement for himself and for his house. And he shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle congregation. And Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other lot for the scapegoat. And Aaron shall bring the goat upon which the Lord's lot fell and offer him for a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to make an atonement with him and to let him go for a scapegoat into the wilderness. Now this is just a brief look at the process of the Day of Atonement as it happened once a year. Aaron himself, as he put on the special garments that were allotted for him to wear on this day, there was a bullock that he himself was to first sacrifice, that he may be prepared, that he may be cleansed, that he may be atoned for. Because again, he is standing as Christ, as our high priest. So he would go and make atonement for himself with this bullock. And then he would come out, gather the two kids of the goats that were for the children of Israel. And then the lots would be cast for them. And the blood of the goat upon which the Lord's lot fell was to be used for cleansing. Were there any sins placed upon the goat of the Lord before it was offered? There were no sins placed upon the goat. See, one of the things that we have to recognize is that the blood also cleanses. The blood defiles and the blood cleanses. But here in the Day of Atonement is the only place where all the sacrifices where we have blood being used to cleanse. Prior to that, all the sins being transferred or confessed over all the animals that were brought to the sanctuary, and that sacrifice then became the inheritors, if you will, of the sins thus communicated. But in the Lord's goat, there was no sins transferred to the goat, because the blood that was going to be used for that was to be pure, because it was to be used to cleanse the sanctuary, to cleanse the people. So here we have just a miniature of the process. Now, what was all atoned for on the Day of Atonement? We read it earlier, but look again in verse 16. Leviticus 16 and verse 16. It says, "And he shall make an atonement for the holy place because of the uncleanness of the children of Israel, and because of their transgressions and all their sins. And so shall he do for the tabernacle of the congregation that remaineth among them in the midst of their uncleanness." Verse 30. "For on that day shall the priest make an atonement for you to cleanse you, that ye may be clean from all your sins before the Lord." So here we find that he was to make an atonement for the holy place, which was to cleanse the holy place from all the uncleanness of the children of Israel. What uncleanness was in the holy place?
The sin.
The sin. And how was the sin put into the holy place? By the blood of the sacrifices, correct? Which tells us that it is through the sacrifices, through the sacrifices, that the sin was transferred to the sanctuary, through the blood of these sacrifices. Because many people wants to, they ask me, how do I know from the Bible, or teach from the Bible, that sin was transferred from the victim into the sanctuary by the blood? Because there's no explicit text on that. But we see here that there was an uncleanness in the sanctuary that needed to be cleansed on the Day of Atonement. And it also says in verse 30 that he was to cleanse them, the people, from their sins. Now, was this also a day of judgment for the people of Israel? It was also a day of judgment. And how do we know that the Day of Atonement was also a day of judgment? How do we know that? Okay, exactly. Same book, Leviticus chapter 16, Leviticus 23 is where it's mentioned. Leviticus 23. Begin in verse 28. Now, Leviticus 23 and verse 28. It says, "And ye shall do no work in that same day, for it is a day of atonement, to make an atonement for you before the Lord your God. For whatsoever soul it be that shall not be afflicted in that same day, he shall be cut off from among his people. And whatsoever soul it be that doeth any work in that same day, the same soul will I destroy from among his people." So God here made it clear that for those who was found not afflicting their souls in this day, they were to be cut off. Or anyone found doing work in this day was to be destroyed. This day also was a day of judgment for the people of Israel. Now, since this was the final cleansing, why did they need to return to the daily offerings again? Because it was only a symbol, right? Because the Day of Atonement was to be final. It was to be the climax of the year for them, in which the sins that they had committed throughout the years, they had confessed, they had repented of, were to be cleansed from the sanctuary, put upon a scapegoat, taken out into the wilderness. We know this. But why is it that they went back to the daily services once again? As it was saying, because it was a symbol, right? It was a figure. And that's when we get to Hebrews. Back to the book of Hebrews now, chapter 10.
They didn't stop sinning.
Neither did they stop sinning. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1 through 4. Says, for the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, could never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered? Because that the worshippers, once purged, should have no more conscience of sins. But in those sacrifices there is what? A remembrance again made of sins every year. And then it says it's impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin. So even in the sacrifices being made, there's a reminder of sin. And those, of course, sacrifices that they brought could never make them perfect. And as we know, in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 5, it says concerning the sanctuary services, it says, who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things. As Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle, for see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed thee in the mount. Of course, I know that this is well known by all of you here. But we find here that the earthly services, the earthly tabernacle, was a symbol or shadow of the ministry of Christ and the heavenly sanctuary. Now, let's look at the biblical teachings about the final judgment. First of all, because of time, we know that Paul himself says in 1 Corinthians 5:10 that all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, correct? The Bible talks about that, and the Apostle Paul talks about the judgment in his day being in future tense. Now, when was the final judgment to begin, and with whom was it to begin? This is where we come to the anchor of the Advent movement, Daniel 8, 13 and 14, correct? Let's turn there, Daniel 8. Daniel 8, chapter 13 and 14. Says, then I heard one saint speaking, and another saint said unto that certain saint, how long shall the vision be concerning the daily sacrifice, that word sacrifice is implied, we know, that and the transgression of desolation to give both the sanctuary and the host to be trodden underfoot? And he said unto me, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. So here again is a mentioning of a cleansing taking place of a sanctuary. Now, when did this 2,300 days begin? When was it to begin? Now, this is just, I'm challenging you right now. When was it to begin? Okay, based off what text?
Based off Daniel chapter 9.
Daniel chapter 9, correct? When we learn about the 70-week prophecy. Okay? So we know that that day ended in what year? 1844, October 22nd to be specific. So we know that that's when a cleansing of the sanctuary was to transpire, or the final judgment was to transpire. Peter in 1 Peter 4:17 tells us that judgment is to begin with who?
The house of God.
Now let me ask you this. If judgment begins with the house of God, does the final judgment only include the people of God who lived from AD 1844 until the end of time, until Christ returns? Does the final judgment only include them?
No.
So then the final judgment would have to include those prior to 1844, correct?
Yes.
All right. Here's a quotation here. I think this is it. I must have skipped it. This is from Great Controversy 486. At the time appointed for the judgment, the close of the 2300 days in 1844, began the work of investigation and blotting out of sin. All who have ever taken upon themselves the name of Christ must pass its searching scrutiny. Both the living and the dead are to be judged out of those things were written in the books according to their works. And how are they to appear if they are to receive their heavenly home? How are the people of God to appear? Without spot, correct? Without blemish. Well, since those who died prior to 1844 will also come under the investigative judgment, does that mean that every member of God's church from Adam to 1844 must have conquered sin in their lifetime?
It's given to us in the gospel.
It's given to us in the gospel. So then prior to 1844, they must have also have conquered sin in their life, correct?
Yes.
If they too are to be brought under the final judgment, if their records are also to be inspected and investigated, and they are to be found without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, then they must have also have conquered sin in their lifetime.
Could that be qualified within their knowledge of sin?
Of course.
Because William Miller was a Trinitarian Sunday keeper.
Mm-hmm.
The angels supposedly watch over his grave.
So was Martin Luther.
Right. And of course, we have more light in our generation. We have more light in our time, which causes us that we have more responsibility. And we're living in an age in which Christ is trying to prepare his church for translation. See, they were not living in a time when Christ was preparing the church for translation, but now we are. So, of course, we have more light given to us, but it's still the same that they, too, were to conquer sin in their lifetime. So then there is no difference between us and them in that respect. They, too, were called to live a life of victory over sin. This next quotation here, Great Controversy 483. As the books of record are open in the judgment, the lives of all who have believed on Jesus come in review before God. Beginning with those who first lived upon the earth, our advocate presents the case of each successive generation and closes with the living. Every name is mentioned, every case closely investigated. Names are accepted, names rejected. When any have sins remaining upon the books of record, unrepented of and unforgiveness, their names will be blotted out of the book of life, and the record of their good deeds will be erased from the book of God's remembrance. So again, there's no difference between them and us in this respect. Their names also are to, their record are to appear without spot. They are to be blotted out just as ours. Now, of course, the work of blotting it out began in 1844. But during their lifetime, they were called to a life of victory over sin. They were called to conquer sin, that when they do stand in their lot, as Daniel was told he would, they could be found without spot. Now, how were they able to cease from sin? Now, of course, we know that they had to have had faith in the power of God. Faith and the promises of God. But I want you to look at another text, if you will. 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter 4. Something that all of God's people have had to experience in order to have that victory. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 1. Bible says, "For as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin."
Amen.
He that has suffered in the flesh, suffered while in this body, suffering from internal struggles and suffering from external struggles. Those who have gone through a suffering are those who have ceased from sin. Now compare this with what James says. James chapter 5. James chapter 5 and verse 10. "Take my brethren the prophets who have spoken in the name of the Lord for an example of suffering, affliction, and patience." God's people have been called to afflictions, to suffering many a times. And we are to take from their examples what they endured. One more text in this respect. Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. And verse 10. Hebrews 2:10 says, "For it became him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, and bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect." How?
Through
sufferings. Christ himself being perfected through sufferings. Now, because we know he had no sin in himself, but in order for him to endure and to live as a man to perfect, to come into perfection, he had to go through suffering. But it was only through that suffering could that be possible. Now, is there a connection between persecution and judgment? I want to study with you the context of 1 Peter chapter 4. We looked at verse 15 earlier. We looked at verse 17 earlier. 1 Peter chapter 4. Now, this text is often quoted in referring to the judgment, the fact that judgment must begin at the house of God. And we often put it in the context of the final judgment, beginning with the house of God, the Day of Atonement, beginning in the house of God. But in context, I want you to notice what Peter is addressing here. Again, in 1 Peter, we're going to begin in verse 2. No, verse 12. 1 Peter chapter 2 and chapter 4 and verse 12 says, "Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. But rejoice insomuch as ye are partakers of Christ's" what?
Sufferings.
"That when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. And ye be reproached, if ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the spirit of glory and of God rested upon you. On their part he is evil spoken of, but on your part he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other men's matters. Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this behalf. For the time is come." Now notice the context. We've been discussing sufferings, right? In the last three verses, suffering and afflictions. And then in verse 17, "For the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore, let him that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing as unto a faithful creator." The context in which the judgment is mentioned is that of suffering. And we know that what was soon to take place, which began around AD 64, was the fierce persecution, beginning with Nero, that went for centuries persecuting the Christians, them enduring the sufferings and the afflictions that they had to go through. There is a connection between that of suffering and that of judgment. The judgment here was not referring to a judgment whereby they would be condemned or damned, but a judgment that would bring them to perfection. A judgment that will continue until the wicked would receive their judgment, which would lead to condemnation and damnation. But this is the context in which Peter talked about the judgment. It had to do with persecution. It had to do with suffering coming upon the people of God. Great Controversy 39. It says, the fires of persecution were kindled. Christians were ripped of their possessions and driven from their homes. These persecutions, beginning under Nero about the time of the martyrdom of Paul, continued with greater or less fury for centuries. Christians were falsely accused of the most dreadful crimes and declared to be the cause of great calamities, famine, pestilence, earthquake. That persecution here signified judgment. It wasn't a judgment to condemn or damn, but judgment falling upon the land. So, when will the final judgment pass to the living? We're living in the days of the final judgment. It begins with the house of God, but it begins with those that have died in Christ, those that have died professing Christ. When will it pass to those of us professing Christ who are living?
At the end of probation.
At the end of probation? At the National Sunday Law? This has been a question that have perplexed many Adventists. Now, though no definite time is given to us, I want us to consider a few passages. First of all, in Revelation chapter 11. Revelation chapter 11. Notice here what we read in verse 18. This is under the sounding of the seventh trumpet, which is the time in which we are living today. The blowing of the seventh trumpet. And in verse 18 it says, and the nations were angry, and thy wrath is come in the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants, the prophets, and to the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them that which destroy the earth. Now, in commenting upon this, I'm just going to have to move along for the sake of time. This is what inspiration says. I saw that the anger of the nations, the wrath of God, and the time to judge the dead were separate and distinct, one following the other. So they would happen behind each other. Also that Michael had not stood up, so the close of probation had not yet happened, and that the time of trouble, such as never was, had not yet commenced. The nations are now getting angry, but when our high priest has finished his work in the sanctuary, he will stand up, put on the garments of vengeance, and then the seven last plagues will be poured out. So here we find that there is a process, a successive process to take place, one following the other. The nations would first be angry, and then the wrath of God would come in the time of the dead, that they should be judged. So the next question is, what will anger the nations and commence the time of trouble? Okay, we read in Daniel 11, the last verse, where it talks about tidings out of the east and the north will trouble him, and he will turn away and go back to make away many. We also compare that with the message of Revelation 18, where the angel is seen with great power, glory, the loud cry, which we know of. Messages, tidings out of the east and the north, the loud cry is going to anger the nations even more than the nations are still angry right now. They're getting, but that which is going to commence the time of trouble. Now, we're not talking about the time of Jacob's trouble, but we're talking about the time of trouble that is to come before Jacob's trouble. And I'm just going to have to read these texts to you for the sake of time here. Early writings, 33. I saw that God had children who do not see and keep the Sabbath. They have not rejected the light upon it. And at the commencement of the time of trouble, we were filled with the Holy Ghost as we went forth and proclaimed the Sabbath more fully. This enraged the churches and nominal Adventists, as they could not refute the Sabbath truth. And at this time, God's chosen all saw clearly that we had the truth. And they came out and endured the persecution with us. Amen. I saw the sword, famine, pestilence, and great confusion in the land. This is prior to the plagues. This is the time of trouble that she's talking of. The wicked thought that we had brought the judgments upon them, and they rose up and took counsel to rid the earth of us, thinking that then the evil would be stayed. So here she's talking about a time of trouble that is to commence. Now let me give you what is written in the appendix of that same book. The commencement of that time of trouble here mentioned does not refer to the time when the plague shall begin to be poured out, but to a short period just before they are poured out. While Christ is where? In the sanctuary. While Christ is still in the sanctuary, at that time, while the work of salvation is closing, so it hasn't closed yet, it is closing, trouble will be coming on the earth, and the nations will be angry, yet held in check so as not to prevent the work of the third angel. At that time, the latter rain, or refreshing from the presence of the Lord, will come to give power to the loud voice of the third angel and prepare the saints to stand in the period when the seven last plagues will be poured out. Now God's people being sealed, God's people being settled prior to the judgments, the wrath of God being poured out, we know that probation will close. But before probation closes, there are going to be judgments in the land, which is going to just enrage the people anymore. The loud cry is going to descend, which is going to enrage the people anymore, and persecution will be rekindled. And as a result of that, we will find, as the great controversy extends into new fields and the minds of the people are called to God's downtrodden law, Satan is astir. The power attending the messages will only madden those who oppose it. Another one, third selected message is 397. Many will be imprisoned. Many will flee for their lives from cities and towns. And many will be martyrs for Christ's sake and standing in defense of the truth. These things will all transpire before the close of probation. Persecutions will transpire before the close of probation. Sufferings will transpire before the close of probation, which will also be worked to prepare the people to stand before Christ without spot, and thereby to stand before God without a mediator. Now, what will that final decree be? We know that final decree would be that he who is filthy will remain filthy, and those that are clean will remain clean. He that is unjust is going to remain unjust, and those that are righteous will remain righteous. That's the final decree that will be made. We are living in the great day of atonement. In the typical service, and I'm having to close up here, so that's why I'm going a little faster. In the typical service, while the high priest was making the atonement for Israel, all were required to afflict their souls by repentance of sin and humiliation before the Lord, lest they be cut off from among the people. In like manner, all who would have their names retained in the book of life should now, in the few remaining days of their probation, afflict their souls before God by sorrow for sin and true repentance. Solemn are the scenes connected with the closing work of the atonement. Momentous are the interests involved therein. The judgment is now passing in the sanctuary above. For many years, this work has been progress. Soon, none know how soon, it will pass to the cases of the living. Now, I only implied when that will take place, because it is not explicitly stated that the judgment of the living will begin at X time. But we see that with the judgments of the living, there has been a connection of persecution, a connection of affliction, a connection of judgments falling upon the land. And I believe that this is what we will see transpiring at the very closing of the work of atonement. Afflictions again, persecution on the rise. Which brings me to what I began with, my opening thought. The most critical oneness that Christ is wanting. Remember that oneness with divinity that we read about. That is that oneness that we all should be aiming for, that we all should be striving for, at one with Christ. But before we can be at one with Christ, we have to recognize the importance of being at one with one another, at one among ourselves. And this is where right now we are very much struggling. We are praying and seeking that oneness among ourselves that I believe cannot fully be seen until we see some persecutions among us, until we see some true afflictions among us. Notice here a few things that I want to give you in closing. What will be the catalyst to produce this oneness among the brethren? This is something that is of personal to me, but it's biblical. We know that God has designed that until the end of time, the gifts of the Spirit should be in His church. Not just the gift of prophecy, but all the gifts, which were meant to bring us to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God. But one that I have often considered and I see that is so critical among us is the gift of prophecy. And we have the Bible and the words of inspiration given to us through Ellen White to bring us to that unity. Yet we still see ourselves struggling. Moses said in Numbers 11, he says, "Would to God that all his people were prophets and that the Lord would put his spirits on them." Now notice what inspiration said concerning the testimony in the last days. She says, "God will have his people disciplined and brought into harmony of action that they may see how? Eye to eye and be of how many minds? The same mind and the same judgment. In order to bring about this state of things, there's much to be done. The carnal heart must be subdued and transformed." God designs that there shall ever be what kind of a testimony? A living testimony in the church. The next page, she says, God designed that his people should be a unit. There's that oneness again. That they should see eye to eye and be of the same mind and of the same judgment. This cannot be accomplished without a clear, pointed, living testimony in the church. Now, I'll let you think upon that. I'll let you digest that. I'll let you see what God is saying in order for this unit to transpire, this oneness to take place. Not only is it going to have to be that living testimony among us that will bring that oneness, but something else that is going to be needed, I think, to bring that oneness among us. And that is sufferings. That is persecution. The sufferings which they, concerning the early Christians, the sufferings which they endured brought Christians nearer to one another and to their Redeemer. That's what we saw in the early church. The sufferings that they went through brought them together like nothing else could. When the storm of persecution, now that's concerning the future still, when the storm of persecution really breaks upon us, The true sheep will hear the true shepherd's voice. Self-denying efforts will be put forth to save the lost. And many who have strayed from the fold. I'm sure all of us know some, perhaps many, who have strayed from the fold of present truth. Here it says, during the time of persecution, when it really, really breaks forth, many of them who have strayed from the fold will come back to follow the great shepherd. The people of God will draw together and present to the enemy what kind of front? A united front in view of the common peril. Strife for supremacy will cease. There will be no disputing as to who shall be accounted greatest. It's that common peril that we hold together. It's that persecution. It's that affliction that will really unite us like nothing else can. Now, why is this oneness so critical? But one of the reasons why this oneness is so critical for us to have oneness with one another, oneness with Christ, to be at one. We read it earlier, but it's mentioned in John 17:21. And therein Christ says, at the end of that, he says, that the world may believe that you have sent me. Inspiration clarifies that for us. She says, in the oneness of Christ's church, it will be proved that God sent his only begotten Son into the world. Not merely in the theology, but in the unity that our theology should produce.
Amen.
That is what will prove like never before that God sent his only begotten Son into this world. Amen. And again, this is the prayer of Christ, which should be our highest prayer. Our focus on what we are praying for in our lives. This is how it will be proved. My closing thoughts. 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Verse 1. This know also that in the last days, what kind of times shall come? Perilous times shall come. Again, this is the context in which verse 12 is mentioned. Verse 12 say, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Are you ready? This is what's going to be needed in order for us as a whole, at least, to stand before Christ and be ready for translation. For us to be atoned for our sins to be blotted out. Now we know the work of getting prepared is an individual work. We're not saved in groups. All of us have a work to do. But it is that oneness that Christ is wanting us to pray for and prepare for. Our master was a man of sorrows. He was acquainted with grief. And those who suffer with him will reign with him. When the Lord appeared to Saul in his conversion, he did not purpose to show him how much good he should enjoy, but what great things he should suffer for his name. Suffering has been the portion of the people of God from the days of the martyr Abel. The patriarch suffered for being true to God and obedient to his commandments. The great head of the church suffered for our sake. His first apostles in the primitive church suffered. And millions of martyrs suffered. And the reformers suffered. And why should we, who have the blessed hope of immortality to be consummated at the soon appearing of Christ, shrink from a life of suffering? Were it possible to reach the tree of life in the midst of the paradise of God and without suffering, we would not enjoy so rich a reward for which we have not suffered. We would shrink back from the glory. Shame would seize us in the presence of those who had fought the good fight, had run the race with patience, and had laid hold on eternal life. But none will be there who have not, like Moses, chosen to suffer affliction with the people of God. The prophet John saw the multitude of the redeemed and inquired who they were. The prompt answer came, these are they which came out of great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we have barely touched the surface of the afflictions of suffering. But I pray that we each will have an impression will cause us to continue to seek and search, that we may be saved at last. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.